The Manifesto. Scenario: in the summer of 1977, the Human League was formed due to the members finding no conventional channels for their immense talents. Background: none of the Human League have any orthodox musical training, but prefer to regard compositions as an extension of logic, inspiration, and luck. Conclusion, Manifesto. Interested in combining the best of all worlds, the League would like to positively affect the future by close attention to the present, allying technology with humanity and humour.
The Human League's Manifesto may have been written by three art school boys during the heady days of punk, but it wasn't truly fulfilled until lead singer Philip Oakey walked into a local disco and asked two schoolgirls to join the remnants of his critically acclaimed but commercially unsuccessful synthesizer group. A few weeks later, Philip and the girls were on Top of the Pops, and the Human League were on their way to becoming one of the biggest British groups of the early 80s. The Human League's success hasn't sustained throughout the 90s, but the trio of Philip, Joanne and Susan have remained fiercely loyal to each other, to the group, and to their hometown of Sheffield.
I'm just proud that we managed to stay together and we're still doing it after all this time, because I think it's hard being in a group for nearly 19 years, which is what we've been in, and being able to keep your sanity. And although I'm sure there'd be a few doubters along the way.
But the Human League didn't begin with Philip and the two girls. In the beginning, there weren't any girls at all, and the music lent far more to the avant-garde than to pop.
Choice. What would you say? The path of least resistance. It seems the only way. But can't we look a little further?
The band had been formed in 1977 by two computer operators with a passion for Kraftwerk and science fiction.
It came to the point where I just started working on a well-paid job and I thought, well, I've got some spare cash for the first time in my life. What shall I spend it on? And I could have learned to drive, which I've never still, to this day, learned to drive. Bought a second-hand car or something and got into all that. Or I thought, well, let's buy the first commercial synthesizer, cheap ones, which is coming onto the market. And so went and bought one. I was always into science fiction and all things science fiction. And also, I think to a certain extent in Sheffield, you're surrounded by strange sounds with the steelworks all the time, you know? You're surrounded by music, yeah. Concrete.
Yeah. The drop forges hammering
drop
away
forges
at night.
I mean, literally.
It was a natural environment for us. They sounded like very natural sounds.
Yeah.
Not alien at all.
The sound of machinery is what we grew up with.
And then we thought, no, we really need a vocalist. And Martin. Yeah.
Well, basically, I used to go to school with Phil from the age of 16, probably. And he looked like a pop star.
I ended up doing 4 years as a hospital porter at two different hospitals, which is a great job, but absolutely no prospect of promotion. If you, you know, work very, very hard for 15 years, you get to be deputy head porter. That's, you know. I would have been lost without the group. I don't know what I would be doing at all.
To level four, I think. Self-belief's the answer. And not another drink. The safe method, the only way.
I thought it was going to be a bit of a hobby. I was very surprised when they asked me, because, you know, everyone was trying to be in bands at that stage and I wasn't. But so when they played me their tapes, I could just go, well, I'm really surprised, lads, that's really great. You're doing fantastic stuff. And which probably helped my prospects with them. But still, when we were doing it, it seemed so left field that we thought that we would mess around with our little tape recorders in a little back room for 2 or 3 years and then go and do what we were going to do.
This is Salter Lane Art College, the first venue that we ever performed at.
Yeah, I was so nervous. I just
was singing the same verse over and over. I couldn't remember the other verses and things. I'd never been on a stage in my life. I'm not suited for it.
Well, no, neither are we, have we?
The tape recorder, which is in fact this tape recorder, that's the very one, would be placed like centre stage where a drummer would be, deliberately, and all the rhythms and bass would be on there. And we just have like keyboards either side, and Philip would be on the mic, and the show started with like us deliberately walking on and like turning the tape recorder on. And stuff would start without us playing anything, which, yeah, it was pretty provocative at the time. This is where we met Adrian Wright. He was in the audience. Basically, he liked the gig, but he approached us afterwards because he was actually, you know, at the art college doing film, photography, whatever.
They said, we've heard you've got this slide collection. And I said, how did you hear that? And they said, oh, I don't know. And it's all vague. And so they said, we're pretty boring on stage. And I said, yes, I think you are, because I saw you on your first concert. So they said, why don't you come and project your slides behind us and liven us up?
It was just so not like a band should be. And everyone did laugh at us, more or less.
Oh, they did. Yeah. We were a joke in Sheffield. We were an affront to their sensibilities. People wanted to hit us and stuff. Yeah.
Well, people did. I remember someone actually threw a pint of beer over Martin and his keyboard, which is a bit shocking because we couldn't have insurance or anything. And I said, oh,
and
my God,
my mouth
people are
going to
give that kind of reaction. We're going to have to do something. So I ended up building a cage to surround my sim to protect it.
Which all the writers thought was a powerful statement of alienation. And no, they did. That's what they all said.
In fact, it was a beer guard.
In fact,
it was a beer guard.
Yes, it was. And it was to stop the invalidation of the hire purchase agreement.
Yeah. You're trying hard not to show it, but baby, I know it. You've lost that love and feeling.
I was really taken with their version of You've Lost That Loving Feeling and the slides. They, you know, they were a very original group. And of course, Phil Oakey looked extraordinary with his hair all. Which side did it go? I don't remember. And I attempted immediately to sign them and was successful. They seemed very avant-garde, and possibly one might have wondered, well, are they actually going to be commercially successful?
Human League's first two albums, Reproduction and Travelogue, hovered around the lower reaches of the charts, and eventually they made it into the top 10 in January 1980, with their enigmatic single Being Boiled.
I remember a review of Being Boiled when it first came out as an Enemy, and they got John Lydon guesting that week, reviewing singles, and I think it started something, or he dismissed it.
No, it's two words.
Trendy hippies.
Yeah.
Listen to the voice of Buddha. Sin, stop your sericulture. Little people like your...
I think I wanted to see if I could get away with it. They'd done a really good backing track, and I didn't know if I was up to the task of being in the group with them, so I just took a tape home, wrote some stuff over, and I was just amazed when they said it's all right. I just went and sung it to them, which was like one of the scariest things I've ever done in my life. And they said, yeah, that's all right.
I thought it was brilliant. I couldn't believe it.
Jaw-dropping, I think.
However, one question remained to perplex and intrigue the record buyer.
What is Being Bald about?
Here's your man.
It was, I'd got some religions mixed up, and I thought that like Buddhism was the same as Hinduism, and it was sort of a plea for vegetarianism, really, against killing silkworms to make socks or something. But I got really confused about it.
Music, carry on your slaughter. Who cares for the little children? You may slice a no-gun.
Even those who got the silkworms were frequently confused by the group's appearance, particularly Philip's.
We went and turned up to do a festival in, I think in Vienna, I think once in France, but in one of them, I remember the booklet actually said, England's leading gay group.
Oh, okay. That's a bit worrying, because I don't think any of us ever were gay. Which is a bit unlikely when you think about it. But it wasn't really a gay thing. It wasn't effeminate. It was somewhere in between. I did have about 10 or 15 years when I didn't wear any men's clothing. But it wasn't really women's clothing either. It was just somewhere else.
Human League had made considerable progress with the music press, but they were becoming increasingly frustrated at their lack of mainstream success.